All right. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining me. I hope you all had coffee. At least that was your chance, because now you're stuck with me for the next 30 minutes. We're going to talk about all the interesting things. And we already heard a few topics earlier, if you stuck on for one of the two talks before the break, that IoTs, well, it's still the big thing, right? Though things get hacked. But of course, the question is, what do the attackers actually do with all those compromised devices? That was kind of the idea behind my talk. I wanted to see what are they actually doing with it. Because if you're the same as me, you see tons of those news articles that yet another IoT device was easily compromisable, exposed to the internet, 100 thousands of those fridges, smart watches, smart TVs, anything like that could be owned. But then the question is, well, why would an attacker actually log into my smart microwave? I mean, I can burn my popcorn myself, so I don't really need them to do it. Is there anything in it, right? So I want to see what is the motivation behind it, what could they possibly do? And of course, for that, we probably should bring it down to the three main pillars of motivation for cyber criminals. On the one hand, on the left side, you get those going after the money, so financial profits, really trying to get, well, their income, if you want to say so, out of it. Could be from stealing credit cards, any accounts that they could misuse for anything else, and of course, extortion, ransomware, crypto mining, all those things that can generate money. And we're going to talk about those to see how much money they actually can generate. Of course, there's also the more targeted attack groups. Some of them nation-state actors, which are also going after IoT devices, but they are not really into crypto mining, at least not on the targets that they go after. So there it's more about espionage, getting information out of it, a little bit of sabotage as well. We've seen that increasing as well. So that's another avenue that we probably should cover. And the third pillar is about the more personal vendettas, ideological approaches, and of course that's also the most difficult one to kind of approach because you don't really know all the people that might have a grudge against your company, right? You can't really try to figure out what's their next move gonna be. Well, you can try, but it's very difficult because they might just do a denial of service attack because they don't like you. They might disclose some information that they hacked from your website because you didn't respond to them on Twitter. Although it might not even have been their Twitter account, but they usually don't care too much. So information like that can, of course, be leaked. So I'm more going to focus about cyber criminals and targeted espionage, but keep those three in mind. And of course, as full disclosure, I probably should mention that I'm not going to tell you about how those devices get infected. If you want to know about that, there's tons of other good talks at RSA that actually go into the details. Or you can fetch me up after my talk, and I'm happily to introduce you to the things that we see from our honeypots. The only two things I want to say is that about 3 out of 4 devices that we see attacking us on the IoT side are routers. So by far, the most common compromised IoT thing is a router, because there are probably also a lot more than smart refrigerators out there. And from our Norton Core telemetry, we actually see that in the US alone, on average, every household has about 6 IoT devices connected. And those could, of course, be the ones that they want to compromise. So how can an attacker profit from an IoT device that he compromised? Well, I came up with 12 possible scenarios of things that we have seen. Some of the most common ones, like distributed denial of service attacks, the cryptocurrency mining, down to proxying or pivoting from the device. And I'm going to talk about each of those 12 scenarios and give you a rating about how likely they are, how profitable they are for the attackers, and then, of course, see what the trend will be for the future, or at least what I expect to be the trend. So let's dive right in, starting with the distributed denial service attack. It's by far the most common payload that we see with bots like Mirai, which is still quite active out there with about 16%. We also see Chitin and other bots using it to do DDoS attacks because it's quite simple. has been out there. The Mirai, let's say, case from 3 years ago is probably still known by a lot of people because it took down a good chunk of the internet. But, well, it's quite noisy, right? If you start misusing any of your devices, like a smart light bulb at home, to start a denial of service attack against some other service provider, they will start blocking your IP address. Even if you do pulse attacks, which are quite popular, so you only send it for 1 minute and then you rotate to the next IP address, to the next device, and so on, makes it a lot harder to block in real time, but in the end, your device will be blocked from the internet, and if it's something in your home network, they might all share the same IP address behind a netted router, and therefore it might be that your complete internet connection will actually be blocked for this service provider. A second thing that we probably should discuss is that IoT also introduces a few new protocols. And some of those protocols, like the constrained application protocol, CoAP, or MQTT, which is a messaging queue protocol, can be used to do amplification attacks. So amplification DOS attacks means you send a small package with a spoofed source address, and the service responds with a larger package back because, well, you ask them a question and they send you the whole phone book, basically. And since you're spoofing the source address, the new larger packet will actually be sent to your target. So you can get a factor of maybe 1 to 5, 1 to 7 with a few of the IoT protocols out there. So that's another reason why, of course, those exposed devices are quite interesting for attackers. But talking about how profitable a DDoS attack is, well, there's a few good numbers out there. A few of those stress tester or booter services have been shut down and the people have been arrested. And we saw that per month they usually made about $5,000 to $10,000. That is, of course, a lot of money, but we'll see later there's more profitable opportunities as well. But still, on the top right side, I'll give them a plus for quite profitable. It's also quite feasible, so it's very easy to do. Even if your IoT device, like the smart light bulb, has not really a good processor, CPU power being low, they can still send data packages. That's usually not really the issue. If they're connected to the Wi-Fi, they have all the bandwidth or nearly all the bandwidth at their disposal. So it's quite feasible and easy to do for them. But of course, it's not so stealthy, as we said. They might get blocked quite easy. You might actually notice that your network connection is saturated. So not really the stealth one, but it's a very common one, as I said, because it's simple to do. So in fact, we see it. It is some kind of profitable, but it's not really the big money out there. Second one, using it to spam. And starting off with just the classical email spam, which we, of course, still see being used. Sending out spam email is not so expensive. You can get, for $500, everything set up to send 1 million spam emails, including the email address that you want to send it to. So costs you a little bit, but there's not too much money in it. But we've seen botnets doing it. ProxyM, for example, used IoT devices and other devices to proxy through it and send classical spam emails. But probably with spam nowadays, we see that many times you still need the SMTP server to actually send the email. So a lot of the attackers either create new accounts on some free mailer services or hijack any of those email accounts that have a password that was leaked, and then just use that one to send out a few 100,000 emails as well. Interesting enough, we saw last year kind of two other spam avenues reappearing, one being the printers, so network-connected printers that might be directly exposed to the internet or exposed through universal plug-and-play, so UPnP. You can connect to them and then send a printing job that they print out something. And last year, it was used by some YouTube star, well, actually not by himself, but someone of his supporter, to say, hey, please go and subscribe to the, this channel and support it. So a few 10,000 printers worldwide spit out those advertisements. And they doubled up afterwards and went actually after smart TVs to play a small advertising video, and also after Sonos, and other speakers that you can connect to and play their own sound on it. So yes, you could use that to do advertisements. It probably would be really, really annoying if you start seeing additional advertisements being brought through those. But the market for it is not really big, so I'm saying it's not so profitable for them. And the prevalence at the moment is nearly zero because you can actually quite easily filter it out. So let's move on to the big one, crypto coin mining. And usually everyone's talking about it, oh yeah, that's what they do, right? And we had a good presentation earlier on from Austin talking about some of the crypto coin mining that we still see, and it is still active. But if you see the graph there, the purple line are the malicious crypto coin mining that we blocked at the endpoint with Symantec, and the yellow line is the value of Monero, which is the classical cryptocurrency that is mined with all those services. And you can see both of them actually went drastically down. And the reason one is, of course, well, if the profits go down because the value of the coin is smaller, then they will start going back to other things where they might still make more profit from it, right? So they go after there where the money is. We still see some people who do the crypto coin mining on IoT. They might hope that the prices will go up, the crypto winter is over. But at the moment, we see a lot of them just using it because it's simple, they have the code, and they're probably still trying to figure out what the next big thing is. But also keep in mind, it's not just that the price dropped, it's also that if we talk about smaller devices, like the light bulb again, they don't really have the CPU power to do a lot of mining. So I have two examples there, the Satori network, was only a few thousand compromised IoT devices, but they only made about $35 per month in 2019. The hide and seek one, also going after Monero, was about $25 per month. Of course, it could be that I wasn't able to get all the addresses where they mined to because there's different variants, but given the range there, that's not really paying a much rent for a cyber criminal. Of course, there are some opportunities. Like the Sominru botnet, which is not an IoT, but they, of course, can harvest all the power from laptops, from any device that actually has real CPU power. And they made about 25,000 per month. So there is still money to be made. And we see some that actually kind of branch out to start cryptocurrency mining, not on the device itself, but having them inject the JavaScript into other websites. But we'll see now that CoinHive is actually shutting down this month. We'll see if that's impacting them or if they still go after it. So what else could they do? Well, ransomware, or locking the devices, right? It was quite popular, at least on the normal desktop side, encrypting files and then asking for a ransom. So could you do it on IoT? Well, you definitely could, but the question is, would you pay $500 to unlock a light bulb that costs you $10? Probably not. If you do, come and see me afterwards. I have some really good proposal for you. But joke aside, I mean, question A would be, would you actually notice that your light bulb has been encrypted? Because for me, it would just be, well, it's broke. I'll buy a new one, right? Unless it's kind of morsing you something and you're smart enough to actually pick up what it wants and get the Bitcoin address right, I don't think it's feasible. So it does not work for all of the devices, right? You need kind of a hub or a companion app on a smartphone. But then again, it's the question, if they are on your smartphone, well, why would they go after the light bulb? Then they just go after the smartphone, right? It's probably more interesting. But it could work for a few things. Your self-driving car, if it's not starting in the morning before you put in $20, that might be a reason to pay if you're late for work. Or I demonstrated in 2015 that you can do it for smart TVs. That is my smart TV there with some Kyrillics asking me for some money. And basically, it's totally feasible. Just think about Super Bowl final, right? 5 minutes before the actual kickoff, you say, please donate 10 bucks to me unless you don't want to see the game. I guess a lot of people probably would buy for it. Again, I don't really want to encourage anyone to do it. So don't blame me if it's happening next year or in the following years. But you could see that stuff like this could happen and could be profitable, right? But we haven't really seen it. Only a few cases where it's usually collateral, mobile phone malware being on it. But I expect that that will actually increase because it is profitable for sure. Next thing to look at is, well, what happens with all the data that it's gathering, right? Maybe you have something like this and saying, hey, I know what you did there. Cost you only $9.99, and we'll delete it and forget about it, right? I mean, there's nothing bad in the picture. That's just me working late, which I think is not too worrisome. Well, I guess you all get the hint that there could be some situations where you might not really want anyone to see all that footage. So that's the real extortion that could actually happen. And it's video, it's voice recording, right? We got the toy Barbies and dolls, which can record stuff. There's been a recent case in the news where a microphone was in a device that nobody really expected it to be. And yes, those things could start recording data, right? Do you really know? I mean, I'm not saying that Google or anyone else actually does it to extort you afterwards. That's not my words. But of course, someone could hack into it and misuse it. And we've seen those cases where they actually hack into CCTV cameras and then really do the extortion. But this time they have a picture of you, email it to you and say, hey, please pay us unless you want to see that on all your Instagram friends' accounts. You can do the location tracking. Fitbit and others have revealed some locations of secrecy military base. We've seen some dash cams exposing cheating spouse because they were actually streaming to the internet so anyone could actually log in. And sometimes you figure out that that's probably not where he lives. At least not for those 2-3 hours a week. So those could all things be that you could do. And you could also go directly after the vendor, right? Although, with all those IoT devices getting hacked again and again, I'm not sure if a lot of the vendors actually care too much. If you say, hey, if you don't pay me, I'll go to the press and tell you that your product is easy hackable. I mean, we see that every week now, right? But maybe if it's a medical device or something like that, where people's life might be at stake, then yes, they might be willing to pay you something. If you tune it down a little bit, let's go for pranks and nuisance. Well, we've seen them as well, right? They're just going after the devices, just for a laugh, playing Rickroll to see how you react to it. There's been a few cases this year where some attackers logged into a Nest camera, the connected camera, because the password was leaked before in another data breach. So someone logged in, they started shouting at the baby, which is also already disturbing. But there was that alleged case where a mother and a son of 8 years, I think, in the US was also targeted. And the attacker then said through the speaker, because the camera, they have a speaker system as well, so you can talk to the room. And they made an announcement that there's an intercontinental missile approaching your city and that you should leave now and evacuate immediately. The lady, of course, got scared, called up 911. They were a bit confused as well. So they sorted it out in the end. But you can imagine that that's not really what you want to have going on if you're home alone or with the kids. But seeing all those, voyeurism, trolling, and so on, they don't really make any profit with it, right? They just do it for the laughs, for the kicks. It's very easy, definitely feasible. It's quite stealthy till something happens, of course, but till then it's easy doable. We see it more and more, but again, as there's not really any money involved, it's probably the cases that will come up in the press because they're interesting or funny, but it's not the big ones where the cyber criminals actually try to make the money. So let's move on to the next one. And for that one, I have one example here. It's my light bulb that I have at home and I played with it last Christmas. And I saw two issues with it. Well, two main issues at least. One, it's posting your private data unencrypted, so without SSL to the backend. You have your email there. You have the MD5 hash of the password without salt, so easy breakable. And the second one is the lower one. Once you know where the data is sent to, you can actually just enumerate and find out all the other people who have the same brand of light bulbs. And if you feel like it, you can connect to it and shut down their lights. without any authentication needed. It's fixed by now, but those are the things where you start thinking, okay, so there's a lot of information, right? There might be some emails, some passwords. People tend to use the same passwords on all the devices, so maybe if you steal it from the IoT device, then you can actually get it to use somewhere else, right? But is it really that interesting? I mean, getting the Wi-Fi key is trivial through that in a lot of cases, but that means you have to be local. It's interesting for targeted attack groups, but the normal cyber criminals, they're more after credit cards, right? Stuff that they can actually use to make money with. And luckily, you don't really enter them directly into the light bulb, but you use them in the smartphone app. So it's, again, the data usually is on some other device. But once you have the data, you could sell it even to advertisers. We know that some smart TVs sell data to advertising companies, so you could try and approach it as well as an attacker. Or you just use it to kind of blackmail again, as we said, personalized scam. Or, as we also seen, try to do a fraudulent warranty case. So you phone up the company and say, hey, my device actually broke down. Here's the serial number. That's my name, but I moved, so can you please send the new device to my new location? And then you just put it up on your auction site and get the profit from there. So low profits to medium, definitely easy to do, but not really that what we expect at the moment. Let's move to the next one, click fraud and ad fraud. So IoT devices, they are connected to the internet, at least in most of the cases. They don't really need much CPU power for that. You just need a little bit of bandwidth, not even too much. And then you can click on advertisements. Or you can like some social Instagram posts and so on, as we saw earlier on with the presentation about the Moot botnet. So does that really work? Yes, we've seen a few. Bamital, it's not on IoT, but they made about $75,000 per month. Or the Hummingbat, which was on mobile phones, up to 60 million in the end, and they made about 10,000 just by clicking advertisements from your device. So they can, of course, misuse that to generate a lot of money. It's definitely profitable, but it's not really prevalent at the moment because it's a bit harder to set up. You might need to set up a fake company to get the money in and so on. So people tend to shy away from it, fortunately, but that might change in the future. So next one, premium services like text messages or premium calls. Well, those devices rarely have phone lines attached to them. This might change this year with 5G coming along. Maybe with eSIM and 5G, some of those devices could be used to send premium text messages that cost you $5 per text message. But more likely, we will see stuff as in-app purchases. The voice assistant system, Alexa, from Amazon, for example, they offer in-skill purchases. So if you have an extension for your Alexa, if you code that one, you can actually get additional content for $9.99 or up to $9.99. We haven't seen any mischief with that yet, but you could imagine that there might be a way to actually do this. But of course, on the other hand, it's easy for the vendor, in that case Amazon, to shut it down, to control their platform. So hopefully they will learn from the mobile side and not make the same mistakes. So it's possible to do something with profits, but it's not really prevalent, and also you're kind of playing the long game here. So let's move over to targeted attack groups. As we said, they're focusing on IoT as well. You might have heard last year the VPN filter group. They were pretty active on routers, various routers being compromised, and they were also persistent on it. So if you reboot the device, they would stay on. It wasn't the first threat that was persistent, but it was one of the first widespread ones. They had various modules. They were sniffing for Modbus traffic, so SCADA, industrial control systems. They were port scanning the local network. And if they found anything that they didn't really like, they could also brick the device. So next time you reboot, or if they force a reboot, your router would actually be dead, and you would lose all your internet connectivity. We've seen other MikroTik routers being attacked a few times. And they have a feature that you can actually redirect all traffic to a remote IP address. And the attackers just enabled that feature so they can set that up, and then use it as a proxy service, resell the IPs, and so on. So that's one thing. But of course, just sniffing traffic, well, is interesting, but now with SSL, not everything is of value there. So one step further is installing malware from an IoT device onto other devices. So for example, Slingshot Group, they hacked into MikroTik routers. They planted a malicious DLL, the IPv4 DLL. And whenever a system admin connects to the router, they would use the official Winbox loader tool. And that one would actually download the DLLs from the router to your Windows machine for whatever reason, but that's how it works. So once you do that, you would actually infect your Windows machine just by connecting to your router. And of course, we've seen other VPN filter injecting JavaScripts that could then potentially lead you to some infected website, or Satori, which scans the local network for some mining groups and then tries to change the payout address. But we also seen some which change the DNS server on your router and then redirect you to phishing websites. So all fair game there, quite profitable, although not really prevalent. And the last one, proxies. We talked a little bit in previous talks about how proxies can be used, either to hide your origin, the Inception Framework Group used that, hopping over multiple routers to make it very difficult to figure out, are this really the Russians, is it the Chinese or the US, or who's attacking me? And on the other hand, you can also use it then to send spam, click fraud, do the credential stuffing, port scanning, because you have network everywhere in the system, right? Not really profitable, but you can use it for Instagram like clicking and so on. So let's summarize it up. We see that DDoS attacks are quite popular at the moment. We think that will go up a little bit. Spam, probably not really. Cryptocurrency mining, yes, it will stay here. Depends a little bit on the price if they go up and down. We say probably stays as is. Ransomware should probably go up because it's profitable. And blackmail and pranks, they will stay here because some of them work, but not all of them. And the other six, so information stealing, yes, it goes up because it's very easy, right? You might get some passwords that you can use. Click fraud, definitely increasing, very often overlooked, but it's quite profitable. Premium services, probably not because it's difficult, no connection. Sniffing with all the SSL, probably not really going to happen. Pivoting, attacking other devices, that's something that we see that will increase this year, specifically with targeted attack groups. And the proxy business, as we said, not very lucrative, but it can be very useful as an infrastructure, so we probably see that happening as well. So let's sum it up. We definitely see there are lots of different avenues to make profits from compromised IoT devices. It's not just the DDoS and the coin mining. Although DDoS and coin mining and click fraud are the three most likely ones that you will see this year on the market. Routers with 75% are the most likely target because they're very interesting, they're connected to the internet, they can do a lot of harm. And of course, as I said, targeted attack groups go after them as well. There would be other devices that we should talk about as well, like medical devices, smart city, industrial control systems, and so on. But unfortunately, we don't really have time for that. But feel free to ping me afterwards. And last but not least, I want to give the RSA apply slide. So what should you do? Well, once you get back home from RSA, hopefully safely after the week, identify all your IoT devices and reboot them to get rid of the malware that is on it or could be on it. Please, please ask first that you can reboot it. So ask the owner that you're allowed to reboot it, not just go and deplug all the routers in your office. Well, could be fun, but don't blame it on me. A few months down the road, I would say probably review all the IoT devices that you have, from heating, light bulbs, everything. A lot of offices do have IoT devices they're not aware of. Make sure they get updated. Make sure you have them integrated in your concept. And yeah, hopefully that keeps you safe. And with that, that concludes my presentation. Thank you. Are there any questions that we have time for? All right, then thanks very much. Have an interesting RSA, and if you want to talk to me, I'm here all week, so just find the short Swiss guy. Thanks.
The short Swiss guy.
Thanks.